Welcome to 1 Million Cups every week. Well, first of all, today is December 10th, 2014. It's National Human Rights Day, and it's National Dewey Decimal System Day. So if you find yourself at the library, be extra special nice to those librarians. I'd like to welcome you to 1 Million Cups. Each week, we present two entrepreneurs, and they share their story and their journey and their business with us. We do about a six-minute presentation, and then we do about 25 minutes of Q&A. And I'm Brian Azorski, and with me I've got Milton and Lance and Courtney. We're your community organizers. And we have our distinct panel over here. If you guys could take a second and introduce yourselves for us. Stand up, please.
Yeah. Good morning. My name is Michelle Markey, and I am a vice president here at Kauffman, for Kauffman Fast Track in particular. So our role is entrepreneurial education, so it's a thrill to be here. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Tom Morse Brown from Morse Brown Creative. I work with my wife and I, and we help small businesses, entrepreneurs, position themselves verbally, visually, for maximum impact.
Good morning, I'm Jerry Glazier. Spent about 30 years in the for-profit, nonprofit sector. Been part of three startups and evaluating two more that I'm working on.
Great. Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and get things started. Today we have two presenters that are on the Passport program. That means they presented in another city and now they're traveling around and doing their presentation in other cities. And our first presentation is from Sam with Pandra Laundry Factory. Come on up here, Sam. This is Sam's ninth presentation at 1 Million Cups, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, well, let's get started. Welcome, Sam.
All right. Hello, good morning. My name is Samson, and I'm with the Pandra Laundry Factory. And Pandra Laundry is the next revolution in wash and fold. And for those of you who don't know what a wash and fold is, it's any service that'll do your laundry for you for a fee. So today, I want to introduce you to the wash and fold hypothesis, touch on the brief history of the wash and fold industry, and then share with you why I believe Pandra is the future. So the wash and fold hypothesis simply states that most people hate doing their own laundry and would much rather have somebody else do it for them. So with this hypothesis, we can see that a latent and untapped market demand for laundry service would exist, and anybody who's able to create a wash and fold business to meet those market needs would make money. But as simple as that sounds, there's a missing component there which we'll need to address in just a few minutes. But first, historically speaking, creating a profitable wash and fold business has always been the holy grail for laundry operators. And going as far back as some of the pioneering owners, we can see that they sought to capitalize on this latent market when they implemented little counters and little windows within their laundromat locations, and they put up big signs that said wash and fold. Now, these early operators believed that the signs would attract the customers and they'd make that money. But I'm going to venture to say that for most of us in this room, we don't ever remember our parents utilizing a service like this. Well, many years would pass and a whole new generation of operators would enter the industry. And they too saw the immense potential of this latent market. But beyond the little counters and the little windows, they fully embraced the dot-com era and they build websites. Now this new generation of operators believe that the convenience of the websites will attract the customers and they'll make that money. But I'm gonna venture to say that for most of us in this room, we still don't use a wash and fold service of any kind. All right, so here we are today, firmly within the mobile generation, which seeks to alleviate all the first world inconveniences with an app. And of course, somebody's gonna create an app for laundry. And as you can see from this infographic taken from a New York Magazine article, well over a dozen laundry by app companies have entered the burgeoning marketplace in the last few years. Now, we got tech guys who themselves have recently discovered this latent market demand, and they believe if they build really cool apps, the customers will use it and they'll make that money. But when we reinvestigate the wash and fold hypothesis, beyond the fact that we already knew that most people hate doing their own laundry and would much rather have somebody else do it for them, the third key missing component we discover is missing is that most people would only utilize a wash and fold service on a regular basis as if and only if it was truly faster, better, and cheaper than doing it themselves. So when we look at the laundry companies that are in the marketplace today through this panda hypothesis, we can now better understand why these companies will continue to struggle to gain our business. None of these companies can do it faster. At best, it's a 24-hour turnaround time, with 48 to 72 hours being more the norm. So no matter how much you hate doing laundry, you can always do it faster than that yourself. None of these companies can do it better. Specifically, when we talk about these laundry by app companies, we see that they utilize a marketplace business model. And that simply means that they take your laundry and then outsource it to the lowest bidding supplier. And that's just bad news for you and your laundry. And none of these companies can do it cheaper. Minimum double, if not triple, what you would normally spend to do the laundry yourself at a local laundromat. Panda, however, solves all these issues because Panda is the world's first systems-based, fully automated assembly production wash service built on a mobile platform. And this is how Panda works. The customer sets his or her own wash parameters and preferences into Panda's forward-facing app, which is not a thinly disguised marketplace, but an actual control panel for its service. Panda will then execute those exact instructions for that laundry as it moves through its system. Panda can do this because it takes advantage of the fact that the steps of the wash and fold process always follow a sequential order. Laundry always needs to be sorted before it's moved to an area to be washed, before it's moved to an area to be dried, before it's moved to an area to be hung and folded, before it's moved to an area to be packaged. So this entire linear movement of materials can then be automated with our custom conveyors. The clothes are tracked with our RFID tags, and all of it is orchestrated with Panda's proprietary software. Now, with this software and system in place, Panda will be able to deliver to the end consumer a laundry experience that is simply unmatched in the marketplace today. The customer will be able to get their laundry back faster, meaning if you bring one load of laundry or 100, you'll get it back in less than 2 hours. Panda will deliver it better. It'll be sealed packaged, and the process will be highly consistent location to location because the process is systems-based and not people-based. And all of it will be done cheaper. It'll cost you less money to use Panda than to go to the laundromat to do it yourself. This will revolutionize the way people do laundry. So how will Panda grow? Panda will grow through a traditional franchising model. We finished our build-out of our flagship location in Springfield, Missouri. We spent the next 2 years operating it to prove the concept, to fine-tune the systems, and to show that we've tapped into this previously untappable latent market demand. We then expand out to 100 franchise locations in 5 years. If each location averages $2.5 million in gross sales, which is about 180 customer heads a day, or 7 to 8 customers an hour, Panda Corporate would achieve a valuation of well over $100 million at the end of year 5. At that point, we approach Procter & Gamble. P&G has shown that they want to leverage their brands through a franchising channel. And we know this because they've established their Future Works division, as well as creating their wholly owned subsidiary, Agile Pursuits Franchising, which controls and operates all their Tide dry cleaning locations, of which 1/3 is corporate owned. And I don't know about you, but I believe a laundry factory is a much better brand fit for P&G with their products like Tide, Gain, Dreft, Bounce, Snuggle than a dry cleaning establishment is. So just as Henry Ford utilized assembly line efficiencies to revolutionize the auto industry, and the McDonald's brothers used it to help create fast food, Panda seeks to create a similar revolution in wash and fold. So I want to thank you for listening to me talk about my laundry business, and I look forward to answering any and all questions that you might have for me this morning. Thank you.
Great. Great job, Samuel.
Thank you.
Your experience doing this shows, so thank you. Excellent presentation. Okay, we'd like to open it up to our panel. Jerry.
I have one question about your expansion, because it's very aggressive, obviously. And even though you mentioned that it's more of a production type of deal through a line, my question is you still have to have people. So if you franchise it or not, how do you guarantee that, A, you can find the right people that believe in your vision and will do it in a quality manner that you can control, even though it's a franchise operation? Because as you well know, sometimes franchises, once they're duplicated and duplicated and duplicated, they lose some of that, you know, the luster that you've put on this product.
And you're absolutely right. Franchises are as good as the franchisees. So obviously in year two, we want to bring on the best CDO possible. There are a few people I have in mind that I would love to work with that have grown capital-intensive franchises out. So that right CDO is key, absolutely. Because you're right, you're only as good as your franchisees out there.
I checked out your brand last night, your website, and I liked your distinctives in your story, being faster, better, cheaper. Seems like that was the top of the list. But it felt, your brand felt like it was a little bit static in terms of your black and white. Could you like talk about that a little bit and how you're planning on, maybe you're thinking about building it out using more color or depth?
Oh, that's a good question. We purposely kept it black and white because that's an aesthetic that I feel would work really well. Black and white because it's very clear. Black and white because it's dirty and clean. Black and white because I like that aesthetic. I think that the simpler you make it, the fact that we use negative space with our logo is kind of my personality too. I feel like the more we're able to make people understand exactly what Panda is, the more successful we'll be. We're trying to open up a market that doesn't exist yet, but we believe in the potential that that market will exist once you bring the product and service to the marketplace. So the easier we can get that message across, I think the better for us. And I think the more colors you use or the more you try to make it complicated, the more it can confuse the consumer. I like to keep it as simple as possible. That's my own aesthetic, so.
Yeah, I spent some time also looking at your website and I love your concept. Can you give us a little bit of information about the team that you currently are working with? Who's all involved with Panda Laundry?
Right now, the core team I have is mainly in development. We have a VPOE for automation. His name is DJ. We have our software engineers. His name is Jody Chafe and David Rudder. We also have our operations person, Rose, who came with me today, as well as a gentleman who's developing our media. And I know that we are sort of jumping the gun by going out with the media first, but it's about getting that message out. We want to make the concept as clear as possible. Sometimes people ask me, when you try to create this market, it's gonna be cost prohibitive. And I say, you're right, if I try to do it all by myself, there's no way I could do it, no matter how well-funded I am. I want the concept to get out there, and I want to partner with Laundry by Apps. Laundry by App companies are a marketplace app, so they need a back-end supplier. Well, why do we have to compete with all these Laundry by App companies? We can just do the back-end supplying and supply and finish out that supply chain while they expense and grow out that market. So these are Laundry by App companies that are getting fully funded to go out to different markets, and they have all those resources. We should tie into that. So I feel like the more we're able to get together as a laundry community and build out this market, because most of you this morning, I would venture to say, never thought about handing your clothes to somebody else you're not married to. But it has to become, we believe that market will open up once a service can enter and actually give them that value proposition. We don't use wash and folds today simply because it takes too long, we don't know who's touching our clothes, and we don't like the way they do it. And that's simply it. But we want somebody else to do it. That's why we get married.
I have that brings up a question about your target market, because yeah. I happen to do the laundry in our home, but it also allows me to do emails, write white papers, research things all at the same time. I'm able to multitask, even though it may not be my favorite thing to do. There are things in life you have to do. So my question is, who specifically are you going after? Who are you really trying to say, this is who we really want to market to?
Well, the answer everybody doesn't want to hear is everybody. But I feel the two key markets that we need to go after are mothers and young males. Young males are already wired to hand their clothes to other people. I mean, as soon as they get in a relationship, they hand it to their girlfriends. And young mothers. Because mothers are busy. There's not a young mother today that isn't working. So they do their laundry on their days off. So they'll spend all weekend doing laundry because they have to, because they want to. They want to do that for their family. But believe me when I tell you, I just have this instinct that if they had an option available to them that was cost-effective and fast, they would utilize it. And that's the market that we go into. Plus, with mothers, I believe that will help us grow. We don't want to spend millions of dollars advertising the traditional way. I could spend millions of dollars with print advertising, radio, television, and nobody will know what they're looking at. But if I can get a core group of dedicated mothers using our service, it'll go out through social media, and they will preach it to their friends, and their friends will preach it to their friends. And that's the way I think we need to grow as a business.
I liked your answer on the black and white idea. But have you considered maybe capturing the faster, better, cheaper in a tagline?
Our tagline as of right now is wash, period, dry, period, panda, exclamation mark. So that's our tagline now. But absolutely, I think that the brand, once we're able to establish the market and we enter that market, I think that is something that we will have to do at some point, because I believe once this market opens up, I believe there'll be a multitude of laundry companies that mimic, because as soon as McDonald's came in 54, Insta Burger King came in, and in 55, Wendy's came in. So I think that there'll be competition, but if you're the better service and you're positioned right, you should be as successful as any other person who enters the market.
Okay, we've got a question here to your right.
Hey, great presentation.
Thank you.
All right, so how many other 1 million cup cities have you presented in?
This is my ninth and my creme de la creme. This is where I wanted to be, and I love to be.
All right, we got to clap it out for that. That's a big deal. All right, can you kind of talk about your experience in those other cities?
Absolutely.
And what you've gained?
Absolutely. In every community I go to, the reason I do the 1 million cups is because as I've been in business the last few years, one of the biggest things I realized as a business person is networking. You read about it, you hear people talk about it, but in reality, you are as valuable as the people you know. Because you can be the most brilliant person in the world, but if you're in a hole, it doesn't matter. So it's about getting out there and being able to network with the right people. Because there are people out there that can help you and can open those doors for you. But until you introduce yourself and get up on a stage or shake that person's hand, they have no idea who you are. So that's really what I took out of all these million cups. So whether it was a small community or a big community, I always felt like I would meet somebody.
Got a question. More. Question here to your left.
Okay, I have a hard time getting a pizza in 2 hours.
Okay.
So how are you going to address a particular facility if you're not only successful, but get in a situation of facility overload in terms of dealing with that time factor?
Gotcha. Okay, so loads come in, it will not all be turned in 2 hours. We prioritize it. Every customer is pegged with their own RFID identifier. So if we have B2B customers, like colleges that we're processing, we know we don't have to return them till the next day. If they go on the loop, they'll be pushed back in priority. A walk-in customer who told us they're going to be back in 2 hours gets pushed up in priority. So even if there's 15 bins ahead of you, your bin will override all those bins and get to the washer first. The reason why we can turn it over in 2 hours is because you break down the wash and fold process into manageable modules. You basically take the whole process and break it down. And then you dedicate single action people at each module, just like an assembly line. When you look at the way they build a car, if you build a car by hand, it'll take you a couple days. But they can output vehicles off a factory line every 15, 20, 7 minutes, however fast they can go. And it's the output time is related to your longest module. So our longest module would be the dry time. That'd be about 45 minutes on average. But every other module would be expeditedly faster. So it's just about getting all the people in at the same time. So how do we get them in? That's the innovation of our software. A dry wash and fold person can only go one customer at a time. So if you come in the third person in line, you have to wait till he finished the first and second person before you get in line. That's why you never get it back same day. Even if you're the 15th person in line, you'll go in at the same time as the 14 in front of you and the 15 after you, because it's all done in modules.
Another question to your right here, Sam. If memory serves me correctly, I think you just recently went through raising capital,
yes.
I believe, to reinvest in your company and the technology and automation. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Okay. So we just got our first couple investors in, and the way basically I was able to get those investors was to get out in front of groups like this, shake people's hand, and ask them if they knew anybody who would want to talk to somebody about laundry. And you'll be surprised when you ask that very specific question, they'll more than not, every once in a while, tell you, I do. And then that's how you get introduced to people. So the way I was able to meet those people was simply by networking, by getting out in front of people and them knowing people, and be more than willing to go anywhere and everywhere to meet whoever I need to.
And can you tell us about the technology that you reinvested in your automation and the conveyors and so forth?
So everything about Panda, the thing about Panda that is exciting for us is that nothing is custom. I mean, other than the software, nothing is, the automation that we use is not automation we had to create. It's automation that already exists in the marketplace. We just shaped it into our laundry facility. So the only thing custom about our whole system is our software. So we were able to basically build out this factory because of the fact that those pieces are in the marketplace. We just reimagined it in a laundry space, basically. So.
Got a question here to your back left.
What market research have you done on population demographics and that type of thing?
Okay. We have real-world market research in that we operated the traditional Washington Full Service in Springfield the last 2 years. We service two colleges, BBC and as well as Evangel. But in terms of a national market research, we haven't done that because there is no way to do that research because you're trying to get them to understand a concept that doesn't exist. So the only thing about the market research I have, and it sounds like a cheesy answer, but it's like right here. I truly believe that market is there. But I have experienced it myself with the customers I've served in Springfield. Because single mothers, a lot of times my concerns were that they would be hard to adapt. Like, they couldn't break their habits. I've had people tell me that they've been doing it this way for 30 years. They're not going to just change it overnight. And then I would service these colleges, and I found that busy mothers were the first ones to adapt because they're the ones that were looking for answers but didn't know where to find it. So once the player came in the market, they were there. So,
question right here in front.
There's a growing market of young women, young mothers that are really not wanting to use chemicals in any of their products.
Absolutely.
Are you addressing that?
Of course. The consumer will be able to tell us whether they want to use green products. And if they want hypoallergenic soaps, if they want us to add bleaches or not, the consumer sets the wash parameters. So they're able to do that.
Question here in the middle.
Samson, loved your presentation.
Thank you
for that. I've had about 20 years of integrating processes and people and technologies. And I'm wondering if what you're thinking about in terms of testing. Because if one thing I've learned is that it's never works out the way you expect it to work out. And so what I'm wondering is, have you thought about a very small pilots with, let's say, elderly living places or older people's homes or places where you can test out your processes, test out your franchisees, and see how those things kind of come together and see what you learn from that?
Absolutely. I mean, I think every time we go to market in any capacity is a test. And I believe that the assumptions I have today are going to change. I know that what I have as a clear picture in my head will morph over time. But I won't know that until I go to market, test it, go to these facilities. But absolutely, I feel like I will learn as I go. And that's why I believe the sooner we can get to market and the sooner we can make those mistakes, quote unquote, the farther ahead we'll be. So I fully anticipate this market to open up, whether it's Panda that does it or another company. I'm going to sit here today and predict that within 3 to 5 years, there will be a laundry service marketplace. And we want to be the ones that are in it. But other competitors will come in. And our goal is to be the one that's far ahead of the curve, that has already made those mistakes, that has already figured those things out. And that's something we're only going to be able to discover by doing it. So, and you're right about that, doing the market research, absolutely. So,
question on your left.
How much does it cost to set up the facility, a facility like what you have now, and how much space does it take?
That's a very good question. It's a $3 million capital investment, but it's on a 3,500 square foot facility. 3,500 square foot because we want to go into every pad site in the country. However, I don't want that to scare you. SkyZone is a franchising model today that has sold well over 100 franchises around the country and is a $2 million build out. So there are franchisees out there that will invest capital into a capital-intensive franchise build-out as long as they believe they'll make their money back. And I can always use the McDonald's example, even though that's a bad example because they've been around for 7 years. McDonald's costs you millions of dollars to build out, as well as you got to prove that you have millions of dollars to weather the first few years. But people buy into it because they know that's the closest thing to a guarantee when it comes to a franchise.
Got a question here in the middle.
So, like, talk about the numbers. Like, 15 years ago, I found a laundry place that did it, like, a really cheap per pound.
Okay.
It was the greatest thing ever.
Okay.
Dropped it off at night, picked it up in the morning.
I'll tell you our call. Okay, go ahead.
But I couldn't find another place that was as affordable. So what are the numbers as far as how much is the average you know, service cost, and how many people do you need to do a day for that $3 million investment to break even?
Okay, you need 90. You need 90 people a day to break that to break even every day. So at 180 people a day, that would give you $2.5 million at the end of the year. Our cost is around $250 a load. So that's our cost. And I believe, and obviously because it's economy of scale, and because the more customers we get in on a particular day, the unit cost will drop. But at the range of 90 customers to 180 customers, it's around $250 a load. So that means if we price it at $3, $350. So if you do three loads of laundry, which is about average for a single person for a week, we could actually make a very thin profit at $10. So do we want to do that? No, we want to hit a little bit more fairer price that gives us a little bit better margin. I believe you could hit 15 to 20 for a week's worth of laundry if I could get it back to you in 2 hours, fully packaged, and you don't have to worry about it. We would want to drop unit costs for members, mothers who bring in 10 loads of laundry at a time. We give them memberships, and they would get a greatly discounted price for it. But we're incentivized to do that because then we have a subscription-based revenue stream to our business where mothers will bring that in. So.
Sam, we've got a question in the back to your right.
Okay.
Coming from the renewable energy field, one of your fixed costs, and it's probably going to increase with time, will be your electricity and costs for, I assume, heating hot water. Have you given any thought to how you're going to try and fix that or control those escalating costs in the future?
No, definitely the way we're going to fix that is to continue to try to invest in the newest technologies. Most laundromats budget about 20 to 25% of their budget to utilities, and that's where about we will be, except a little bit on the high end, because we have the automation component involved as well. But the only way we could get around that is to look into green technologies that will become more and more available in the marketplace, and we will be able to implement that into our facility. So if they come out with a better technology for boilers in about 10 years that are much more efficient, we'll implement those in all our Panda locations. If they come out with better washers, and then washers are becoming more efficient every day. So we use the latest washers that are the most efficient that can give us the best return on the investment. So,
Sam, thank you so much. Okay. One final question before we let you go, and that is, as a community, what can we do for you?
You know, if you know anybody, like I said, who would love to talk to somebody about laundry, I'd love to talk to you. I just want to get in front of as many people as possible. I mean, the whole reason we came up here this morning was because Kansas City is a community that I don't have the ability to come into all the time, but I know there's a huge community here, and I would love to access as much of it as possible. I feel like I could bring value to the person I speak to, and I know that anybody who would love to speak to me, I'd love to, I would appreciate their time, and I'd love to be able to talk to them as well. So, thank you.
Thank you, Sam. So we've just got a couple of quick announcements here for you. If you've got one of your announcement sheets, if you look on the back, there's a Business Basics for Boomers session coming up on Friday, December 12th through KCK. Also, the Enterprise Center of Johnson County is doing a term sheet structuring the deal with Rick Vaughn on Thursday, December 14th at 11. You can see more information on the announcement sheets there. So our next presenter that we have coming up from Make It Easy Auto is Nick Penka, and he's going to tell you about how Make It Easy Auto is a performance-based website wherein dealers pay for sales and not leads. Welcome.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. As he said, my name is Nick Penka. I am CEO of Make It Easy Autos. I want to thank the 1 Million Cup for inviting me up today to speak with you, and I want to thank you guys for taking time out of your busy schedules to learn a little bit more. I was supposed to grab this. A little bit more about Make It Easy Autos. So May 9th, 1950, Sam Walton opened up his very first Walton's Five and Dime in Bentonville, Arkansas. At the core of Sam's belief was if he stocked his store with enough variety of product and sold it at a low price, he would be able to compete with the retail giants of the world like Sears and JCPenney's. Make It Easy Autos has that same philosophy when it comes to selling vehicles online. On average, consumers visit 8.8 auto websites before they even go to a dealership to test drive a vehicle. The main reason for this is inventory. Consumers want to make sure that the vehicle they are going to test drive is the perfect one for them at the lowest price. And because no website, I missed a slide. Because no website has all of the inventory, consumers are left to jump from site to site. The reason no websites like AutoTrader and Cars.com have all the inventory is because they have a model called lead generation. Lead generation is charging dealers in advance for leads. What this does is this puts all the risk for the sale on the dealer. And this business model over time has turned out to be a bad return on investment for dealers. So dealers all across the country are pulling their inventory off of these auto websites and investing that marketing dollars in other ways to get a better return. That process has been tough on dealers and consumers, but it hasn't kept consumers from buying vehicles. In 2013, 15.5 million new vehicles and over 15 million computers and tablets were sold in the United States alone. Yet in a century that saw remarkable change to the car and the computer, there has been little ways that the change to cars have been sold online. The internet was supposed to dramatically change the car buying process by offering consumers better information and the opportunity to be in control of the process. It was also supposed to give auto dealers a more effective, targeted channel for finding buyers. But what's emerged instead is a broken system based on selling the names of consumers who are researching vehicle information. This system, known as lead generation, revolves around monetizing a customer's desire to get information on a particular car and a dealer's desire to know who's shopping. These are the websites that I was telling you about earlier. These are the branded names that you've seen all the time on your television. Make It Easy Autos, though, is called a performance-based third-party website. Performance-based auto websites don't charge dealers monthly fees for leads. Dealers join Make It Easy Autos for a one-time fee of $850, and after that, they only pay us $375 per sale that we bring them. The national average per vehicle retail is $616. What that means is that's the amount of money that a dealer allocates per vehicle on his lot, his or her lot, to sell it. So in essence, we are charging a dealer almost half of what it costs themselves to sell their own vehicle. We are also applying for patents on what we call our high alert system, which allows us to track the consumer through the buying process so that we know when a vehicle is sold. Here are the benefits to the dealer. There's no risk. Dealers don't pay until a vehicle is sold. Dealers get true quality buyers, not just watered down leads. They get free advertisement every month, and they get a great return on their investment. Like I told you, the national average is $616. It also raises the dealer's finance and insurance revenue stream. Here are the benefits to the consumers. Consumers can easily find vehicles within two clicks. A customer can see all the vehicles in the area that they can afford. Through our personal information protection system, customers don't worry about unwanted sale calls from pushy dealers. And because we have lowered the barrier of entry for dealers, we will eventually have all the vehicles in an area for the consumers to look at. The benefits to Make It Easy Autos and our investors. We have the ability to sign up every dealer, which gives us a marketing edge over our competition and a great reason for consumers to never leave our website. We have more control over the customer through the buying process in the similar ways that Walmart has control over the customers through their buying process. We have great profit margins, and we have no limits on our potential growth. This is a quick look at the website. It's black, as you can see. There's nothing on it. That part didn't work. Anyway, here are the steps to success for Make It Easy Autos. We are interested in looking for ways to become educated and raising capital here in Kansas City. Part of that investment money will be to improve our website. See, some of the things that we need to add to our website to give the customer a better experience. We need to add loan application and approval process automotive reviews, ratings and reviews, side-by-side comparison, curbside service for test drives, manufacturer and dealer specials and incentives, manufacturer advertising for new vehicles, and we also are creating a back-end system that gives individuals to be able to sell their vehicle on our website as well. And we also are looking to hire a sales staff across the country, including here in Kansas City. Ultimately, our goal is to have every dealer's inventory on Make It Easy Autos by 2017. So that's a six-minute elevator pitch of Make It Easy Autos. This is a little bit about me that I'll leave up there while I answer questions. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer it. And I thank you for your time. You guys are the first to go, right? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. It was very well done.
Thanks.
I do have a few questions. As I looked around your website, there wasn't the functionality for me to put in a radius, a mile radius. So the cars I was pulling up may be like in Lebanon, Missouri.
Right, right.
What are your plans to build out some of that functionality?
At this particular time, we have 59 dealers from Springfield to Joplin to Fayetteville. And I've signed up dealers in St. Louis, but their inventory is not yet on the website. As soon as we add up dealers in Kansas City and St. Louis, we'll add the ability to search regionally, put in your zip code, and be able to search closer to your house. But right now, there wasn't a need for that in Springfield.
My second question was that it appeared that most of the cars tended to be high mile cars. Do you have new vehicles on there as well? Are you planning to do that?
We have both new and used. The cars that sell the most for us are the ranges between $5,000 and $12,000. It seems to be that our marketing has led a little bit towards this. Our ability to tell, which I couldn't show you, was ability for people to find vehicles based on their monthly budget, which tends to be a lower budget range. You know, people looking for cars that fall within a smaller range. So we sort of have more dealers on that right now, or used car dealers, but we have both.
So final question then, which that leads me to, is tell us a little bit about your target market, if you would, please.
Our target market is mainly females. We started out marketing in Springfield as a way for consumers who control the household budget, and in most cases it's the female of the house, to be able to say, this is what our budget is for our next vehicle, what falls within our range. The story goes, I had a son, my oldest son was turning 15 at the time, and he had a budget up here for his car, I had a budget down here for what I could pay, right? And I said, listen, I wish there was a website, this was before I started, I wish there was a website where I could put in, your budget is $250 per month. Go find the cars that fit within that range, and then we'll go look at them. And that would have saved a lot of time. So we really started targeting the females of the house. That's our target demographics, you know, for the most part. Kids as well, who are becoming new drivers and looking for, you know, a new car. Yes, sir. I don't have black and white on my website, sorry. It's just black, as you can see.
So I did see your website.
Good.
And it seems like you have a really great story. So I was reading through, like, your main emphasis kind of being that you protect the consumer from the sales, which is a really neat idea. And it seems like your emphasis and a cutting edge. But I felt like your website, it didn't have that same kind of cutting edge to it. It felt a little bit generic, a little bit WordPress, you know, style.
Right.
So have you considered really tightening your brand to be cutting edge, where you're not using like a lot of colors, a lot of different fonts?
I knew that question would probably come after you asked him his question. We had a choice early on to go a certain way. And one of them was a wider background, you know, and more modern look and stuff like that. In particular with our area that we started with Springfield, Missouri, we tested a few things and we got back positive reviews on a more vintage look. I don't know if that's the right word for it, but our thought process was targeting to moms and stuff like that. We wanted to keep it a little bit more, not vintage, but we went for that look. I think growing forward, as we grow across the country, that look will have to change. But in our area, it worked really well. And I'm not saying that's a negative in our area, but they really tested positive for a warmer colored look when we ask, you know, I think we sent it out to about 300 people and they came back positive about this look.
Nick, my question happens to do with potential competition, like the CarMaxes of the world and how you plan to deal with them, along with, for anyone that's in this room that's either a member of Costco or Sam's, where they can, you know, go to their 800 number and whatever. How do you combat that type of competition?
Well, ultimately, we are a marketing company. Our best ability to make profit and to grow is our ability to market our website. And our ability to market our website directly is connected with how many vehicles we have on it. Our ability to say that we have all of the vehicles gives us a leading edge over the competition. I understand that I told the story that we built a little boat and we pushed it off into the Pacific Ocean in intent to grow this boat as we went across it, right? And that's kind of where we started in Springfield, is that way. Our ability to compete in this world is really based on the fact that we will be able to have all the competition. We will be able to give the consumers more through the process because we control some of that. Incentives, gas cards, all kinds of things that we have collected from our partners to be able to give to the consumer that the dealer can't or that other people can't. Auto Trader, I would say our competition is everybody, but Auto Trader, Cars.com, these traditional ones who do the most marketing are. I'm going to give you an example. TrueCar. TrueCar started out in California, and now you see them marketing in our area. I'm sure they're marketing here as well. Their business model is as closely directed to ours as any of them, where they don't charge till after a sale has happened. And what they have been able to do is uniquely market themselves, although that's got them in trouble in Kansas and other places for the way they do that. It's been able to get themselves tremendous growth in that market. So that's kind of where we see ourselves going. Did that answer your question?
Awesome. We'll go ahead and open it up to the crowd. So if you have a question, raise your hand and we'll come by with a mic. Milton will start us off over here.
I had a conversation with a friend of mine who's mid-80s. He was having trouble getting into and out of his Lincoln because he has to get down. And I suggested, you know, maybe a small SUV. So on your website, you might offer some information on the ease of ingress and egress for, you know, the baby boomers who are getting older and can't quite get down into that, you know, sports car anymore. And, you know, where the seat would right, allow right. them to just sort of slide sideways.
Right. Any website walks a fine line with putting too much information on a website that bothers people, you know, that confuses them, and too less. Right now, we have too less. What we've got back from our responses is we need a little bit more information, like you're mentioning, to help people in certain situations. But one of the main complaints, and Auto Trader admits this themselves, is one of their main complaints is that they're too busy and it confuses people really quick and they leave the site, right? So we have to walk a balance there of getting people to not be frustrated because of all the noise, you know, on the website, and getting them enough information. I think our ability to do that, to be able to quantify who they are, their, you know, what their interests are, and give them all that information, we can do that eventually.
Got another question right
here?
Yes, sir. I had a question about your revenue model. If it's a pay-per-sale, how is it that you're tracking that it's the person who came to your website that then went to the dealer to get that sale, and it's not somebody who went to cars.com or any of your other competitors?
Right. That's usually my first question, so I appreciate it. And I don't know if I can get online. I could show it easily the way that we do it. We give, in our system, we give the consumer every detail about the vehicle, including the city that it's located in, but we don't give the dealership's name. The one step in the process that's different with us than everyone else is, before we send a consumer to the next step, which is communicate with the dealer, ask, negotiate with the dealer, go look at it in person, is they have to let us know who they are. And in letting us know who they are, we then have the ability to communicate with them after, which is part of our process. There's also a process that's set up for the dealer to move up in the search. So when you go and you search for a certain vehicle, the dealers that have the highest rating on our system get the first level, right? And they get that because they communicate with us. They say if Sally Smith showed up, if she didn't, if she bought, if she didn't, and we're able to communicate with them and Sally Smith. Then we also have the ability to, on most dealers that join, to see their what's called a CRM, which is their back-end system that they take and they say who showed up, when, what times, what bought, what sold. And then there are other processes that we get. We get state information on registrations, which help us narrow it down. At the end of the day, if I don't get anything back from the dealer, from their CRM, from the state, I get it from the consumer. It went great. I'd give the dealer this rating, and I bought the car, that kind of stuff. That's kind of how we get to our point where we can track the consumer. There are other things in there that I'm saying out loud because it's part of our system, but we started in 2013, and we've sold over 500 vehicles or helped sell over 500 vehicles, and only twice have had issues with where that person came from. Was it from, you know, another system, Auto Trader or something, or us? So we've been pretty successful at that. Anyone else?
Got a question here up front.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned that the other similar website doesn't charge the dealers up front to join. I was wondering, and you said that you charge $850 for a dealer to join. You have sales reps going out to sign up the dealers. It would seem like you're not really making that much money per sale. Why don't you just do what this other organization's done and allow them to come on board for nothing?
You mean like TrueCar? Is that what you're talking about?
Right.
No, TrueCar, you do have to pay to join TrueCar. TrueCar's model is similar to ours where you pay for a sale, but you do have to pay to join.
But why not allow them to come in for nothing? You'd have more inventory
It was a chicken and the egg situation when I started. I needed the inventory, so I gave that to the dealers for free. Now that I have, you know, over 14,000 vehicles and am growing, you know, in different areas, then there is a small charge. The charge is mainly for what it costs me to decode their information and to for my programs to put it in the right places and organize it. There's a hard cost to me to get them on. Most times, there are a lot of what's called aggregates, the companies that push information to the web, push vehicle information to the web, and there's different steps you have to go through for the different aggregates to get it to work on our system. So for me, there is a hard charge. And at first, I didn't charge the dealer to get on, but now a lot of times it's a situation where if you don't charge them, it's almost like worthless to them. Meaning they don't have any skin in the game. You know, they don't pay attention to it. There's things that you could do on my website to help yourself sell a car. You can communicate with a consumer on my website for free. If you go on my website and you say, and you click on a car, a dealer can send you a little note on my computer, not to your email because they don't know it, saying, hey, this car is $500 off this week and only, you know, and we'll give you gas money if you want to come look at it. They don't know who you are. They can't call you or anything like that, but you can see what's going on with their car. So the dealers that have done the best with my system have worked it. And the ones that pay put a little bit of skin in it, and so they tend to spend more time on it and help sell cars.
So, Nick, another question for you. I think every startup struggles with building a product and selling it. You got to do both, and you got to divert your time to one to the other. Can you talk a little bit about your team and how much is being put towards developing this platform, and on the other sense, how much is being put out in sales and marketing, and how do you divide your time?
Good question. I have two programmers. When I started out the business, I had a partner who was a programmer, and I learned really quick that programmers have a choice. They could either put in time to make money, or they can put in time to make money in the future, and they like making money now, right? So part of my agreement was the ability to buy his shares out early on, and I'd done that. So I have two programmers who spend their time doing the certain things to the website. It's more expensive than I ever dreamed it would be. Programming and the amount of time, and especially a website that's as detailed as this, that has thousands of inventories of different cars. On average, dealers sell between 30 and 50% of their inventory every month. So every month I'm getting new cars to process, communications, all that kind of stuff. So that was really more expensive. My time mostly is traveling to meet with dealers and do the marketing of it. That's my background, was marketing. So I travel to St. Louis a lot. I come up here to Kansas City. I've met with several dealers up here. I'm going to Oklahoma City and places like that. So I have a development team that works on that, and most of the time I do the sales marketing part of it.
Nick, I have a question. This is regarding, as you continue to build out, is it possible or have you been approached by any of these other competitors saying, we'd like to take over your deal, or we'd like to take it and expand it, or we think it'd be a good match with what we're doing because you do some unique things? Can you talk about that a little bit, or is your plan is that you will just stay who you are and continue to expand your brand and image?
Our approach is to grow this. We actually, long story short, is the very first presentation I did at a 1 million cup was in Springfield, and a guy walked up to me afterwards and talked to me, and that has sped up my business growth tremendously because he had a product that he couldn't monetize, and I have a way to monetize it, and we've worked on this thing since then. It's been a month or so, and that's worked perfectly. Our plan is to grow this organically, starting in Springfield and growing out until we get big enough. Right now, we're not big enough to really make an impact on their bottom line. They're not losing as many sales to us yet. Eventually, more and more dealers, the more and more they pull off of these pay in advance for leads websites, the more we will get noticed, you know, that type of stuff. But our hope is to grow ourselves this way until we get big enough to determine what we want to do at that point.
Question on the left.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I totally get the benefit to the dealer, and I totally understand why they're going to join up. How are you going to get me, the consumer, to come to this site instead of going to all the other ones?
I have one unique property that is my best ability to market myself now until I get all the dealers, right? Until I get all the vehicles, I market myself as the easiest way to find a vehicle that you can afford. So if you go to my website and you click on, you could pick, my budget is $250, what falls within my range? We use our system to show you all the vehicles that fall within your range within two clicks. So that is my marketing tool right now. That's what's got the people coming to my website and me selling cars. Eventually, my plan is to be able to market as the website with the most vehicles because there is no barrier of entry, including ability for individuals to put their vehicle on my website for free until it sells, right? So right now, my marketing is geared towards female mothers who know the budget and are interested in seeing what falls within their range.
So as I've interacted with your brand, your website, your presentation, you got a lot of information. Have you considered, like as you go forward, really maximizing on some of these key distinctives, like your two clicks, you know, the customer is protected from the sales, and really like honing in on some of these really unique concepts that make you, and getting those out in very simple ways on your presentation, on your website, so people get it really quickly?
Yes. Matter of fact, I mean, I wish I could show some of the ads that we've done, but those are the two biggest points. Their ability to, within two clicks, see the vehicles that they can afford, and their ability to search our website and never worry about a dealer calling them, you know, pushing a sale on them. Those are our two main marketing points. We do about 65% of our marketing on television to build a brand because we're competing with big brands. And the rest, we do some online stuff. We do some retargeting, some stuff like that. But our biggest push right now is those two items, which you say is our separates us from everybody else.
I've got a question for you here in the back.
You mentioned you look at sales in your area. What kind of market share do you have, and how long have you been selling?
We launched in February of 2013. And the first year mainly was about determining how our website worked and what consumers needed more. And then we've worked on the website and fixed it up a little bit. Our share is very small, but our budget is small too. I'm gonna give you an example. Let me give you a true life example. A dealership in Springfield, which is a fairly inexpensive place to buy marketing, the biggest dealerships probably spend about $500,000 a year on marketing, of which most of that is through co-ops. So meaning the manufacturer pays give them money back to do the ads, and most of the ads are about the cars. So one dealership group in the area only markets themselves. They don't market their cars, and they spend about $250,000, and they're the 10th largest dealership in that area. We spent $50,000 our first year and about $60,000 our next. We haven't spent a big budget, and we would fall probably, you know, somewhere in the 20th range right now in the number of cars sold. So we have grown, we have done a good job of using the small amount of budget that we have. Eventually, our budgets in every area that we go will have to be competing with the big dealerships group. The big dealership group in St. Louis called Bomarino, they spend $6 million a year in St. Louis alone marketing their cars, right? So eventually, our marketing budget has to be similar or close to those to be able to compete with them. Did that answer your question? Yes,
so,
ma'am.
So I do have a question, and I just want, maybe you can confirm it for me. So right now, if by looking on your website, and you say your target market is women, I would go there if I were possibly looking for something for a 16-year-old or 17-year-old, because that's probably the range of cars you have on there right now. Am I understanding you correctly that you at some point want to get the big dealerships to also sign on with you and new cars as well? Because I don't know that and this again is a question, that to say that the female is specific enough of a target market for you.
Well, okay, but 95% of all Americans eventually end up buying a car based on what it costs them per month, right? So at the end of the buying process, you're sitting there in front of a dealer, and you're looking at this car that costs $20,000, $30,000, and you say, how much is this going to cost me per month, right? Most Americans don't have $30,000 to take out of their pocket and give to the dealer. So at the end of the buying process, you have to come down to what it's going to cost you per month. Our system starts there. Now, why we have sold the lower end cars has maybe a little bit to do with our marketing, and it also has to do with the fact that men in general are looking for a specific vehicle. Men in general, and being in general, say, I want a 2015 Chevy Silverado, okay? What 2015 Chevy Silverado can I find? Cars.com, Auto Trader, we could do it too, but they're sort of market to that demo. Look, you're looking for a certain vehicle, we'll help you find it. We say, our target is, you know what you can afford for a vehicle, we'll show you what falls within your range. So we sort of flip it around. What that does from a selling perspective, when I send that person to the dealer, is the dealer now knows that person started their search based on $300 per month. They know where to start. So they can go right to that person and say, listen, I know your budget's $300 a month. We have this special finance, blah, blah, blah. We'll get you into the car. And it works really well. I don't mean to be, you know, I don't mean to say that females aren't looking for specific cars, but a lot of times, I'll give you another example. My wife was wanting out of a minivan, right? She was through her minivan stage and wanted a nice little red sports car of some sort. She said, well, I can't afford a Ford Mustang or Chevy this or that, and I happened to find a car, a Hyundai Genesis Coupe, which was $10,000 less than those, red sports car that she loved. She didn't even know it existed. So our thought process is to introduce the consumer to a new set of cars maybe they never heard of that fits within their range that they can now afford and go look at.
Nick, thanks for coming out. We appreciate hearing your story. Patented 1 Million Cups, last question.
Sure.
What can we as a Kansas City community do for you?
A couple things. First of all, I am currently calling on dealers in Kansas City, so if you know of a dealer and you don't mind tweeting them or Facebooking them or something or letting them know that you saw the presentation and you think it'd be interested to meet me, I am 80%, when I meet a dealer, 80% of the time, when I meet a decision maker at a dealership, 80% of the time that dealer joins. The problem is dealers get called on more than any other business, I believe. And because of that, they have a lot of roadblocks set up, gatekeepers set up, to keep people out. And so getting to the decision maker is one of my biggest things. And most of the time, connection with people who know dealers helps me get into the right person. The other thing is we are looking to hire in this area. Always interested in meeting qualified salespeople, and maybe even if they know marketing on the back end, that would help as well. And the other thing was, as I mentioned, we are interested in learning and being educated on funding abilities here in Kansas City, and I'd be interested to talk to you then. I do want to show you one more thing. We started a program in Springfield where we gave a car. The last 2 years, we've given a car to a high school student who pledged to not text and drive. So we went, we partnered with the hospital in town and the television station and others. We went from to 56 high schools, did hour-long assemblies, and got kids to sign a pledge, not text and drive. And this is Sarah. She won our car last year that we gave away. It's a big opportunity. We want to do that here in Kansas City as well. It's a very important topic that's going around now. I just wanted you guys to understand that that this is a way that we can partner with marketing companies locally and give a car to a student who pledges to not text and drive.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Nick. All right, that wraps it up for today. Same time next week. If you'd like to present, please go onto the website, click the Apply Now button. Before you go, Friday, December 12th has been officially proclaimed by our mayor as Kansas City's Ugly Sweater Day. So please be sure to tweet, Instagram, message all of your ugly sweaters. The idea is to raise awareness for Operation Breakthrough. Great foundation, great cause. So wear those ugly sweaters this Friday, and we'd love to see your pictures. Have a good one.